Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm back with a second video. And as I said, the rapture is only for listeners. Heaven is only for listeners. Hell will be filled with people who don't listen. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I had a dream, and in my dream, those of you who have seen my video, if you go back on my channel a month or two ago, like in the beginning of April or March, I had a vision, not a dream, a vision from the Lord of, let me repeat it. I had a vision, and in my vision I was in heaven. It only lasted like 5 or 10 seconds, but I was there, and the Lord was in front of me, and he was standing on the glassy sea or something like that. In front of the throne, and he had a scroll in his hand, and that scroll was the scroll from Revelation chapter 6. Had not been opened yet, and the Lord took that scroll, and he touched me with a scroll, and I was revived. Revival. Then he turned. I was, like, say, on the clock. I was at 6 o'clock. The Lord was at 3 o'clock, whatever. Yeah, I mean, like, I was at the bottom of the clock. Let's put it that way. I was at 6 o'clock. The Lord was to my right, and then there was a bride to my left, straight across from him, like at noon or midnight. And then the earth was straight across from me. The throne of God was behind the Lord Jesus Christ. So he was in the midst of the throne, in the middle. And he touched me with that. And then he turned to his right, faced the bride. He touched the bride with that scroll, and out of the scroll came, it looked like a river of gold, but the Lord told me when I was making the video about this vision, don't call it really a liquid gold, but it was liquid love, liquid light, liquid love, liquid life. As a liquid love, liquid life. To go back and watch my own video. You know, when the Lord shows you something, it's fresh manna now. I can't remember all the details unless the Lord reminds me. I had to go back and look at the thing myself or have notes on stuff. So anyway, it was liquid life and liquid love and liquid gold, and it overcame the bride, and the bride became part of that river that was coming out of the scroll. She was gone in the river, and that's the rapture. Then the Lord turned to his right again, and he faced the earth, like we were way above the earth, like you were in outer space or whatever, you know. The earth was like, it was still big, though. We're pretty close. And, you know, anyway, I guess about the height of the moon, let's put it that way, I guess, the distance from the earth to the moon, something like that. So it was taking up the whole wall, but it wasn't, you know, it wasn't tiny, it was big. So about where the moon is. You know, think about the moon. You got the four blood moons, but you know, the moon is also like the bride. I made a video about that a long time ago. The Lord has showed me that a long time ago, so he's reminding me of that now. You know, the sun, the S-U-N, is like the S-O-N, you know, he's illuminating earth, representing mankind, right? The sun illuminates the earth, and then the sun, S-O-N, illuminates the mankind, the world, the creation. And then the moon reflects the light of the sun. So it's like the bride, the moon is like the bride in the fact that it reflects the light of the sun, right? And it also reflects light back on the earth, though a weaker light, but it still reflects light on the earth. As the sun reflects, you know, the reflection from the sun on the opposite side of the earth. This is something I've made a video about, but this is connected. I wasn't even thinking about it till just now as I'm making the video because of I had a dream last night. I'm trying to get there, but I have to just flow as the Lord would lead me. There's something there. There's four blood moons are somehow connected to that, to the bride too, and I'm thinking about it as the Lord is leading me on it. So then after the Lord turned to the earth, he turned to the earth, and it was, I couldn't see him, but it was as if he was pronouncing judgment on the earth with this, you know, opening the scroll and all that. I couldn't see him opening it, but that's what was happening. In other words, while his back was to me, it was like the tribulation was going on. The bride was already gone. I had already been anointed and revived. The bride had disappeared. He turned to the earth, and the tribulation happened. Of course, I couldn't see it. It was just few seconds, and then he turned back to the throne with that same scroll, and it's like he put the scroll into the, you know, it was a bright light, like, you know, it's like the Father's there, whatever, that's the throne. I couldn't see into that light. It's like the Father. And then he put that scroll in there. And then, you know, the Lord was telling me that he had reconciled all things to himself, that he might reconcile all things to God, as the Bible tells us in the New Testament. So the Lord Jesus Christ reconciled all things to himself, of the bride and the creation, all this, that he might present it to the Father. So that's what I saw. So last night I had a dream. Let's see if I can explain this. Because the Lord has given me an interpretation that is way out there, connected to this, what I just shared with you from the vision. Let me just try my best. I asked the Lord to give me the ability to explain it, because this is at the edge of my capacity by the grace of God. Anyway, so in my dream, I had my house, and it had 444 light bulbs in it, and they were those new light bulbs, these energy saver or something, new light bulbs. I had 444,000 of these really expensive light bulbs, and in my dream, everybody needed to have these light bulbs. And then I told people, I went outside and I was telling people, hey, you need to have these light bulbs. Some people got some light bulbs. Some people had 3 or 4. Some people had 10. Some people had 20 or 30 different amounts. And then some people had none. And they were like, they didn't understand me. They couldn't understand me. They weren't listening. They didn't have an ear to hear. They were out there. And then, and this is a whole different level of it. This is the first level of this dream. So, or the first meaning, okay, the natural meaning in this first level. The other levels connect to the vision I gave you, which is very interesting. I'll try to get to it. So, I saw other people, like I saw Sister Linda Kirby, who I just mentioned in the last video, who I met in Nashville. She's got this newsletter that she started doing in April, you know, and the Lord has really blessed it. The Lord had given me a word of knowledge, and the Lord told me to message her, you know, out of the blue. The Lord said, message Linda Kirby and tell her that her newsletter is going to take off. It's going to be big, really big. Excuse me, a whole lot bigger than she imagines. So I did. And then it did. Her newsletter exploded into thousands and thousands of people looking at it. So praise God for that. So she was one of the people there, like the main person I was dealing with. There were other people who were also do YouTube or whatever, but I didn't really see their faces. But I knew there were other people, not just myself and not just Linda Kirby. I want to say that. There were others too, but in this case where I was talking to her. And what the point at this level of the dream is that Linda Kirby was explaining to people in very simple, childlike terms and natural understanding, you know, that they needed the light bulbs. And she was explaining to them, and this is really, the connection is her newsletter. You know, she was explaining to them in a way that they could understand, unchurched people or non-really not so Christian or not Christian, new Christians. She was breaking it down to them. Hey, you need this light bulb. And she was telling them that, you know, all the reasons why they needed it. And so then they said, they accepted the fact that they needed some light bulbs. So they put some light bulbs. So, they ended up having 2 or 3. Before, they didn't want none. They didn't want to have nothing to do with it. They weren't interested. And so they got a few. And they had them on. And then, you know, they were asked. I can't remember if it was me or somebody else was asking them. Maybe it was me. I can't remember. Why do you have those light bulbs? And they're like, well, I don't know. But I know I need them, but I don't know why I need them or what they're for and what they do exactly. But I know I need these light bulbs. And so then I was able to go into a greater detail on the spiritual side of why they needed those light bulbs. And then they begin to understand. And then they realized they needed more light bulbs. And then, like I say, in this case, it was Sister Linda Kirby who was talking to them more. And they added more light bulbs. And then later on, I was able to explain to them why they needed the light bulbs. So in other words, it's not just in this case, I believe personally, the Lord was showing me that, you know, that, it's true. Of course, my videos, brothers and sisters, are for discipling people. But people need to, you know, it's just like, people need to be evangelized first before they can be discipled, you know. So people need to be evangelized into the fact that we're living in the end times and things are serious. Time's almost up and there's no more games. And they need to get some baby food and some baby milk before they're ready for the meat. And so we're all a team, brothers and sisters. That's why I thank the Lord. as an example, and Sister Linda Kirby, and the Lord is using her for that. Give some, well, not necessarily all that she would do, just like Paul Begley. It's not necessarily that he's just giving people baby food, but it's generally speaking, the stuff he's doing with news reports and all that too, and a video instead of a newsletter. It's the same thing. He's throwing it out there, and then people that are not Christians, people are non-believers, they see it. They say, hey, yeah, that's right. I remember when I was a kid, I went to a church and I heard something about 666. I heard something about, yeah, the mark of the beast and, you know, Antichrist and all that. A river turned to blood, even though it wasn't turned to blood. It was turned to the color red, the color of blood, but it wasn't literally blood. In China, wherever, in these places, and then boom, they get woke up. And then they understand, hey, I need some light bulbs. You know, and then they're ready, by the grace of God, they're ready to move on to the meat. And know all the details of why they need light bulbs and what the light bulbs do. So that's the natural level and the first level interpretation of the dream that the Lord gave me, brothers and sisters. And that's what I was intending originally to make this video about, which I just made. I just discussed it. The initial level of what my dream was. But when I was praying a little while ago, the Lord dropped the bomb on me. He dropped the bomb on me that the dream was much more deeper than that and much more important with the 444. So the dream, the number of lights was 444, 444 lights. And the Lord, that's like the most important thing of the dream. So I was like waiting to hear from the Lord about today. Of course, I had things to do, been busy as it is in life, brothers and sisters. My wife doesn't have a driver's license yet. Only a permit, so I had to go to the grocery store, this, that, and the other. And I've been thinking about it and waiting to hear from the Lord and doing the videos and all these things and studying and answering people's messages and all these and giving people words, etc. Anyway, so tonight, before I made this video, I started praying, brothers and sisters, and the Lord just dropped this on me that 444, there's lots of levels to this. But number one, the Lord showed me something I never would have thought about. You know, that's at the beginning of this, I already explained the vision. You know, there's four. The Lord turned in four directions. He turned to me, he turned to the bride, he turned to the earth, and then he turned back to the throne. So there's the four there. There's the four blood moons. We know about that. There's the four watches of the night, which I already made a video about these things. You can go back to my channel, like in March, end of February maybe, and see the videos of the vision, awesome vision that the Lord gave me. They're pretty just right in a row. Okay, and then the Lord told me this. I didn't even think about this, and I'm not into any kind of numerology and all this stuff, but there's gematria, whatever, biblical numbers. Okay, so there's meanings of these things biblically. Six is the number of man. Seven is the number of of completion. You know, the Lord rested on the seventh day. Three is the number of the Trinity, right, of God. One is God. Two is witness, you have to have a second witness, walking in agreement. Two represents agreement. How could two walk together except they be in agreement, right? Amos 3:3. So three, you have your Trinity, you know, the nature of God and Trinity and all this. The perfect, you know, the completion of God, completion in God is three. Seven is completion in all things and everything, but three, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So anyway, the Lord just shocked me or surprised me tonight when he said, 444 is also what? There's three fours. So it's God in four, in four. So what is the four? Well, the four is as I said, there's the four blood moons, which I dismissed, or I wouldn't say dismissed. I didn't see it as a major thing. It's just a coincidence. And the Lord told me, if you guys have watched my videos, you know this is true, that the Lord, evolved me on that, changed my mind on that, just like he changed my mind on other topics about the five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins. The Lord has corrected me by his Spirit on that. I mean, originally I thought that it was not the church, but Israel. And the Lord corrected me, sovereignly told me, no, that's about the church. The five wise virgins are those who will be raptured, and the five unwise that don't have any oil will not be raptured. It's the church. Matthew 25, not Israel. And then the Lord corrected me about the blood moons. The Lord said, yes, there's something to these blood moons. And then about the Shemitah year and all that, well, Rabbi Kahn, I didn't say, I never had anything against Rabbi Kahn, but I was like, I heard a preacher say, well, it's a fiction. It's a work of fiction. It's not really prophecy. It's fiction. and it's a bunch of junk. I read an article by a preacher who I respect who said that. So I dismissed Rabbi Kahn's teachings about the before the Shemitah, the original one, the harbinger. But the Lord sovereignly told me, at the same time he told me about the blood moons, he said, I want you to study this, the work of Rabbi Kahn. This is from me. And then about the Shemitah, the harbinger and all that, and the Shemitah. And then the Lord told me, you know, about the four blood moons. He said, yes, this is from me. And it's a significant meaning for the world. And it's from me. It's a sign from me. Okay, so that's why I started looking. You know, it's from God. This is really from the Lord. And so the Lord has shown me these things. And so there's the four blood moons, the four corners of the earth, you know, the north, south, east, and west. There's the four watches of the night. The bride disappeared at the second. The Lord turned to me like the first watch, 6 to midnight. 6 p.m. until 9 p.m. is the first watch of the night. Okay, then 9 to midnight is the second watch. So the bride disappeared. Jesus said in the parable of the 10 virgins in Matthew chapter 25, at the midnight hour, the cry rang out, behold, the bridegroom cometh. So the midnight hour, in my opinion, unless the Lord tells me different, of course, is meaning the darkest point of the night. And when it can't get any darker, going into the night, you know, that's midnight. And so when the Lord turned the second watch to the bride, and then she disappeared, it's the rapture at the midnight hour. You know, and then from midnight until 3 a.m. is the third watch. The Lord was facing the earth, and it was time of the tribulation period. So, etc. So, and that's why, of course, the rapture will be at the last second. When all seems lost, at the midnight hour, the Lord will get us. You know, just as the flood, like in the story of Noah, you know, just as the flood's getting ready to come, you know, the Lord had Noah and those guys in the boat, and they escaped the flood. Just as, you know, even Lot came out of Sodom and Gomorrah just before it was destroyed. Those kind of things. So anyway, brothers and sisters, so there's three fours to be 444. So the three representing God in the tribulation and the end times. God in his work in the end times of what the Lord showed me, those four phases. Revival of the church to become that bride without spot or wrinkle. Now, I want to say this again, as I mentioned in the last video, people can't listen. And thank the Lord I only have a few. I have a few people that troll me. Thank the Lord. Other people have a whole lot more trolls because I try to be diligent in explaining things the best I can and repeating them over again. And it's sorry for those who, you know, I have to do it, the people that can understand, to try to give that 100th opportunity to people that don't have an ear to hear. Because they'll misrepresent and misinterpret what you say. Now, whether it's on purpose or their lack of mental capacity or what, I don't know. But I'm just waiting to hear exactly what the Lord is trying to get me to say about this thing. The church revival, since 2011, brothers and sisters, lots of you guys have been revived. You've already been revived. You know, it's individuals. People that are part of the bride are the ones revived. Now, myself, I got revived and set on fire by God in 2001. Now, all but about 6 months or 1 year of that period, I've been in revival. Now, in 2008, I think I told people, I don't think I ever mentioned the video. I might have said it in that radio interview. I can't remember. But anyway, 2008. I got so wore out with all the nonsense I was dealing with in the Philippines, I decided I was going to stop doing the mission work. You know, I found out later as I researched that the average missionary only makes it 1 year. I was in the Philippines for 8 years. So most missionaries don't make it past the first year. But so I started, ran into a wall after my first year in the Philippines. I decided I wasn't going to do the mission work anymore. I sat down from the ministry for about 6 months, I think it was. And then the Lord, let's put it this way. Well, you know, the Lord can sometimes be loving toward us, and sometimes he kicks us in the behind. And in my case, the Lord basically pretty much kicked me in the behind until I went back to doing the ministry. The Lord didn't allow me to quit the ministry, but I wanted to. So all but that time period, by the grace of God, by his grace and mercy and his love and choosing me to serve him, I've been in revival since Well, really, it was since September 2000, October 2000. I've been in revival, so praise God. And many of you, and we're talking about individuals. Many of you have been in revival since 2011. So, you know, there's nothing to say that these old dead churches, you know, they've already fallen away. It's nothing to say that they're going to be on fire, even though some of them might get set on fire. I don't know that. I highly doubt it, but it's possible. But those who'll be raptured, nobody's going to be raptured. It ain't in revival. It's not that bride without spot or wrinkle. So that's where people get confused. They say, oh, you know, Brother Patrick, you said that I said in a video a long time ago, I'm very discouraged about revival in the church. The churches, I'm talking about the brick and mortar organized religion that you all know. This here that we're doing is like a house church, but it's, you know, individually, we're the body of Christ in a non-man organized system on YouTube. I'm not talking about them old religious people. You know, the vast majority of people in churches, those tares, those little cliques that control and run everything, lots of people, as a matter of fact, brothers and sisters, I'll say this, a lot of people that I've ran into in my 15 years in the ministry, most of your active church members are in there for ulterior motives. Let's put it that way. A lot of the churches want to build their denomination, build their own church, their own kingdom of their church, build the kingdom of their denomination, like Southern Baptist or whatever. And then you get people that go to the church because they love to sing. They just want to go there because they love to sing in the choir. And not even necessarily Christian songs. They just want somebody to see them sing. And then maybe their heart ain't even about performing for the Lord or singing for the Lord or bringing revival or touching people's hearts or even ministering to God or man. Their desire is to be seen. You know, God knows these things. You run into these things. A lot of people who are wealthy who go to churches, they're not going to church because of any other reason, but hey, they donated some money for some pews, and then they put their name on the side of the pews. I have some relatives that's got pews in the church with a little plaque with their name on it, things like that. They want to be a pillar in the community, you know, part of their, maybe their business people or whatever, and then, you know, it's like part of networking for their business. Oh, you know, they're pillars of the community. You know, the husband is a deacon in the church, so therefore, you know, they're good people. Let's do business with them. You know, that kind of a thing. The largest church here where I live at, Southern Baptist Church, I have relatives that go there. And, and the people that I know who go there who are really serious Christians, you know, they say that, hey, there's lots of networking going on at our church. You know, lots of people making business deals, and they go there to be seen by people for their businesses and all this. It's horrible. Sad, but that's the problem with organized religion, brothers and sisters. So thank God for an opportunity like YouTube and that, you know, the churches that I started them all as house churches. And then, of course, they eventually became brick and mortar churches. But for me, I like to see it stay at about 30 people. And yes, 30 people is a lot of people to have in a house, too. Believe you me, it gets pretty hot. But about 30 people in a house church to me is an awesome church. Just like in the book of Acts, they met in people's houses. If you read the letters of Paul and read the book of Acts, you'll see they met in houses and stuff. And no command like when they're going to put new carpet in their big padded pew church, they'll always quote about the temple and all that. There's no mandate in the New Testament to build a building. You know, all that stuff about the temple, that was for Israel only in those days. Anyway, I got off track here, brothers and sisters. You know me. So there's so many layers to this, brothers and sisters. I'm just talking about the first one. Maybe I need a video about each layer. So the first layer is revival. We already got that, most of us. And so revival is coming to those who God has predestined to be part of the bride. Those who are called, many are called, but few are chosen, Jesus said. So those who are chosen to be part of the bride, they will be on fire and revived and without spot and wrinkle if they're going to go in the rapture. We need to be. So that's the revival that we're talking about. To be kind of worthy to escape these things, as Jesus said in Luke 21:36. You know, God will make us worthy by His Spirit. Those who will go in the rapture. Now, maybe I'll make a video about the other ones because I'm already at 24 minutes. Let me go on to part two. The bride, of course. The second phase was the bride, which I already talked about a little bit. Of course, the bride, that liquid life coming from the scroll, that scroll that the Lord is holding in Revelation chapter 6 with the seals on it, that's the title deed to earth. He's the kinsman redeemer. That is his title to redeem us from this earth. He is our kinsman redeemer, like the story of Boaz and Ruth, the great grandparents of King David. He's the kinsman redeemer. That's every story in the Old Testament you see is all a type and shadow and a cross reference back to the one and only Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah, the Christ, Jesus. It's all about him. Everything you see is a type and shadow about him. Like Jesus said, you know, in the volume of the book is written about me. In there, in the Bible, you think you have eternal life. Jesus told the Jews. That's why I don't know why these people keep worshiping Israel. He said, you think you have eternal life, but those scriptures speak about me. Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Like the song, I'm sorry, from Michael W. Smith, I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I made it, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. That's a nice song. It's all about you. It's all about Jesus. Sometimes I use that song when I'm messing with my wife. You know, when she wants to do something, I'm trying to do something, ministry something, and she wants me to go with her, I'll start singing that to her. It's all about you, you know, as a joke. But it is all about Jesus, brothers and sisters. It's not all about us. It's about Jesus. It's not about the Jewish people. It's not about any of those things. It's not about even Moses or whomever you want to talk about. It's not about Noah. It's all about Jesus Christ. Because he is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. That's including Israel. No Israelite comes to the Father except by Jesus. Jesus said, nobody knows the Father except the Son, and no one knows the Father except whom the Son reveals him to. So in other words, Jesus, God, you can only know God if Jesus reveals the Father to you. Only through Jesus. So nobody knows the Father except through Jesus. Praise God Almighty. Praise God Almighty for Yeshua HaMashiach. There's one mediator between God and man. That's our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God for that, brothers and sisters. Don't let anybody try to tell you any different because they're calling Jesus a liar. They're calling the Word of God a liar. Anyway, so God is not a man that he should lie, the Bible says. Let's see. So there's part two. I mentioned about the bride and going into that liquid light, the liquid love coming from the scroll, the title deed, Jesus is a kinsman redeemer, rapture. The bride disappeared into that river of liquid life. Liquid gold, liquid love from the scroll that the Lord had as the kinsman redeemer. Our Boaz, he's our Boaz. And then the Lord turned to the earth. That's the third part. Now, like I said, there's three fours. And I'm talking about three levels of that. Three levels of the, you know, there's four positions that the Lord turned to. And then the Trinity is the three. And then the Lord, you know, I'm giving you at least three layers of that. There's three main layers. And I haven't even got it all illuminated in my mind from the Lord yet. But that's what he's talking about. There's three levels of understanding of this. So, he turned to the earth, and then he had the scroll, and it was the tribulation period. Now, we know about that. The church won't be there. That's the time of Jacob's trouble. Between Revelation 6 and 18, it's when the scroll is up and the seals, and then the vials, and then the bowls, or, you know, the trumpets, and then the seals, the seven seals, the seven trumpets, and then the seven vials or bowls is the third set of those. So there's three sets of seven in this case of the trumpets. Seals, trumpets, and vials or bowls. So, and then the Lord turned to the Father and reconciled all things. I'm going to cut this off now. I need to, you know, pray about it more. I've just touched on it and just scratched the surface of what the Lord's trying. The Lord keeps bringing me back to that vision. It's a pivotal vision. And at the time, I didn't realize it. And then until, you know, how important it was to the understanding. And I thank the Lord for that, brothers and sisters. I thank the Lord for that. So God bless you all. I will get these loaded, and then I'm going to be praying. I ask you guys to pray. Of course, anything you know you feel that the Lord is leading you about these topics, feel free. You know, I don't mind anybody sharing what they think the Lord is showing them. It's, you know, you guys who follow me, you know that. I just don't like it. People are trolling you, calling you names, and mocking and insulting and things like that. Of course, I don't tolerate those things. I don't allow it on my channel to get people's focus off what we're talking about. The topic is Jesus. The topic is the gospel. The topic is the tribulation, the rapture, and our soon to be with the Lord, that's the topic about Jesus, about the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. When Jesus talked to the disciples after his resurrection for those 40 days before he ascended into heaven. For 40 days, Jesus kept appearing to his disciples. And it says in Acts chapter 1, he didn't talk about the board of deacons. He didn't talk about deacons. He didn't talk about anything church business. Jesus talked about the kingdom. He talked to the disciples about the kingdom. That's why all this church cliques and all that I've been talking about in this video, it's meaningless to me. You know why? Because it's meaningless to the Lord. All this cliques and all this nonsense going on in organized religion. Jesus didn't talk about it at all. He didn't say, oh, this is how you set up the church government. This is how you do this. This is how you do that. No, he talked about the kingdom. So that's what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the kingdom. And Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise God through whom all blessings flow, brothers and sisters. All things. The Bible says all good things come from above. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name.